y'all did about 2-3 years ago.
Yes.
It's been a while. It seems to go so quickly. Has just been admired. I've seen so many pictures that are based on that. People, for different reasons, will go and stand in there and have pictures and portraits taken. And one of the things that we have learned is that everything other buildings are getting tagged, but they do not touch that. There's a sanctity about that. So that's what you all do, and what it brings here. Really, it's a talking point, but it just really does a lot for our community and is enjoyed by many. So thank you.
Well, thank you, Mayor San Juanita Sanchez, for coming and letting us interview you, but also for giving us the opportunity to work with you on this mural.
Yes.
And other opportunities.
A lot of
as
things
well.
About it.
Yes. You could talk about that as well if
sure.
you like.
Sure.
But you know, we're interested in hearing about your story.
Okay.
And you know, why you decided to.
Why did bring you here?
Yeah, why'd you bring us here?
Okay, I will.
Because they think this is pretty crazy.
Wait till you hear the story. By way of background, I am the youngest of 10 of a family that has been raised here in San Juan. My parents met in San Juan. My father was born in Harlingen. My mother was born in Los Lobos in Matamoros, not Matamoros, near, what's that name of the, it escapes me, about close to San Felipe in Tamaulipas, just across. My grandmother is the one that brought the family over. They sold their animals and brought what they could, and my grandfather, they came over illegally. They got a coyote that brought them over. They settled down Stewart Road, and they worked in the farm. They got caught, deported, came back again, got caught, deported. So the third time, my grandfather says, you know what, ya no vamos a ir, ya nos quitaron, ya perdimos todo, yo ya no vamos, nos quedamos aquí. Dijo mi abuelita, está bien, quédate, pero yo y mis hijos nos vamos. The very next day, she got away to bring us all back, and my grandpa came along. He was a smart man. And that's how they ended up in San Juan, and my parents met here in San Juan on 3rd Street, and they lived there, and then we moved across where I live, and I have always lived at that area, at that address. It's right across the shrine. So I'm entrenched in this community. My roots are here. But I was born in Moorhead, Minnesota, because I come from a migrant family. So I never knew a summer in the valley until I was 21, because I graduated from the university, at that time was University of Pan American University. I got a degree in finance, and then I kind of worked at a bank and didn't quite like it and kept on doing other things. Master's, started the program, and then I got accepted to law school. So I went to Thurgood Marshall, and I've now been practicing law for almost 20 years. And I came back to my community, and it is because of my law degree that the people sought me, because they knew me, they knew my family. So they thought, since I have a law degree, I can now answer all the questions. And I was standing outside my house when they stopped, and they says they're closing down the library. That's not right. And they can't do it because there's federal monies involved. So you need to help us. I'm like, what library? I didn't even know we had a library, because we didn't have one. At least not much of a library. And that's how I got pulled into a meeting with a council. And the next thing I know is that they're walking out after I've been asking questions. They got up and walked out of the meeting. And I said, well, what happened? And they said, well, because we're asking questions. And it just kind of, all of a sudden, the library became my cause. Mm-hmm. And it really did, after it got its own life. And then I understood that the community was concerned enough that this couldn't happen. And it was a tiny little place. And so we began to do more research. The budget for the library was $35,000. You can imagine that. That was just the person that was working and cleaning, which means that we had no book selection, no anything. But that kind of opened my eyes of how people wanted or have needs, but look towards somebody to try to help them. But the reason I brought you here, and that's how I got started. Somebody asked me, do you have your thought of being mayor? I said, no. I said, well, would you like to run? Sure. And that's another story that I'll tell you another day. But the reason we're here is today is a very special day. Today in my life, in the sense of 11 years ago, my father passed away today. I was on my election of 2005. It was my fourth election. I had lost all three before. And I ran this last one in 2005 because nobody was going to run. And I was at a city meeting, and I'm not even know what the topic was, but I said, please, gentlemen, don't do that because you're going to make me run. And they laughed because I've lost all my other elections. And, well, they did do whatever it is I didn't think they should do. And lo and behold, I won by 6 votes. But the Friday, right before my election, my father passed away from he had a blow to the head when he fell. And we had to disconnect him about 11:30. And it's real significant because my daddy already had written a corrido for me because he was a singer.
Oh.
And he was going to sing it at the victory party on Saturday because he was definitely convinced that it was going to happen this time. Mm-hmm. Well, on Saturday, my supporters went out and took care of the election. And of course, I was with the family at home. And being very traditional, my father was lo velamos en la casa. We brought the body to our house, and my daddy was with us. Of course, we were minding our own business, doing everything like we would do when he would there lie down. And it was just kind of really surreal of being in this situation. Even if I had to write a book, I don't think I would have thought this kind of a chapter to write. At the end, we had a rosary. Our wake was at the house, and the rest of the people that came were by word of mouth, because we didn't tell anyone, because the rosary was the next day. That night at around 7:30, the rosary's in full swing, if you could say that, when my sister whispers in my ear, you won. You know, and you couldn't really even enjoy it because of what we were in, but it was really something. So when the rosary was over, I looked over to the people. I thanked them for being with us and accompanying us, and I also thanked them for electing me their new mayor. And so people started screaming at the same time, and everybody went, I said, no, it's okay. I got a feeling this guy has something to do with it, too. And so it was a whole series of things of that weekend. It was challenged, and we had to go for a recount and all these crazy stuff. But my first meeting, I was called to attend on Tuesday after we had buried my dad. And it was about a road that was coming through this land. And it was a toll road. And for whatever reason, because we were so underdeveloped, San Juan was selected as a place where that toll road would come. That toll road would come from this bigger street here, Stewart Road, and it was gonna cut right across through this whole area here, across and over. San Juan is only 2 miles wide. What very little land we have, that's it. When this city was being developed, there was a belief that it should be a bedroom community. And there's really ramifications as time goes on of being a bedroom community. You don't get the tax base or from sales or from tax because people basically would just build their homes and go work somewhere else. And so this is why this big area here really hasn't developed if you look at other areas. So I remember the phone call, and it was the first time somebody called me from City Hall to actually, you know, official business. He says, you need to be at that meeting because this is about to happen, and we're going to pass a resolution, and we've got to stop it. Okay, I guess we got to do that. I didn't realize that at this point, it was going through the MPO, the Hidalgo County Municipal Planning Organization, had already approved the environmental. The schematics had already been done. There already been $3 million invested in this project. And basically what they were telling San Juan was, when we're going to come into your city. And the folks says, but you can't. So I had to take the helm at that point with my opposition, because I'm the only one from my, I guess we say, my faction that won. So I kind of won by myself. Had to organize us to, how do we fight this? And they said, well, we thought we were fighting it, but it's a matter of time. And they're having a public hearing. So one thing I knew I could do was organize people. So got all the crazy people from San Juan that were willing to go with me. None of us really understood what it was, but we knew that it was very detrimental. And basically the odds told us, when TxDOT speaks, and as far as we've gotten, the first thing they told us, you're probably not gonna be able to undo this, but we gotta at least fight it. So we went to the meeting with the county, and they were having a public hearing, and we packed the room. and we got up to speak. And what I was able to prepare from May to that July hearing was get the economic development numbers of how it was going to impact us by cutting this part out. How it would, we were going to have to buy houses out. We were going to have to go through probably affect the Lupe area yeah. that we have, because it was going to start swinging. And we're talking 5 lanes tall, so nothing develops around it, and no exits, which means that that's not going to give you any development. It's just the road going through your street, through your town. And so we had the impact that it was going to make to farmland, impact that it was going to make to the economic development, our tax base, all these things, and our future. When it presented, and the last thing I told them, and if I have to lie in front of the bulldozer, I will. Right? So next thing I know, we've got Strayhorn, who was running for governor at that time, came down to San Juan because she was completely against toll roads. And all of a sudden, it got a lot of attention. But the whole thought was, well, we've already invested $3 million. I remember walking into the meeting room with the commissioner at that time, and the design, it was crazy. It was plastered along the wall. The whole layout of the street was, how huge it was all along the wall, so I could see the schematic, and it was like, oh my God. And it's like, you know, you don't understand. Of course, trying to convince me why I thought it would be good. So I did get advice, and they told me, I think because down here folks have made up their mind, maybe you need to talk to the Texas Transportation Department in Austin. So I remember being at a meeting, I was told, I said, I'd like to get a bus of people. And two buses of people, I told them. And they said, you'll be lucky to get one. People won't come. We took two buses of people, over 100 people, to Austin, to the Capitol, to wait there while we came to the hearing. The people were people. Pura gente. Traigan sus loncheras, traigan sus nietos. I mean, everybody that could thought they'd enter a Capitol. We were graciously hosted by our state representative, Armando Martinez, who prepared us a snack lunch. And I remember everybody's excited, and we were talking about the issues, and we were, and the grandmothers with their grandchildren, the people that took time from work, and we talked about it. And it was just an exciting time. And we got there, we were received, we went in, and for me, it was just the whole experience of what people were owning up to. You know, really, do you think we can make a difference? We have to try. They have to listen to us. We collected 1,500 signatures. And at the meeting, they called us, y'all need to go. The meeting got started, we rushed over. And we had 6 people speak. We had a young lady who spoke about her future in the city. We had her father who spoke about his vision for her. We had a business owner who spoke about the possibilities of what it is to build something here. We had an owner of land in a house that says of their dreams to give to their children their inheritance. We had our economic development person there and our planning to talk about the financial impact it would have. And then it was just, you know, my ability to say, I'm here to speak for the people. We don't want this. We're telling you. We don't want this. And I've been told that when you all make up your mind, nothing will change. And I'm telling you that the people of San Juan don't want it. So the director, the regional director was there. The folks were very just taken back by how the people had responded. And the chairman, I do not remember his name at that time, told our guys, our regional folks here, said, well, the people have spoken. You all need to go back and see what you all need to do. Well, that was November. February, the announcement at the county court was that the toll road would no longer come through the city of San Juan. That it was going to find a new route. They were going to go back to the drawing board and figure out where it would be. And the irony of it is that I'm now the chairperson for the MPO. Years later. But the reason I'm here and wanted you to be here is because there is a way. Never be ever convinced that you do not have a way to be impactful, and that one person can't do that. I didn't do it myself, by no means. But it's triggering that, and but making people take ownership of what we can do. And when we united and organized, we now have 80 or almost 90% with the Lexus coming in of the luxury vehicle south of San Antonio. people come from all over. They sell cars and fleets into Mexico. The first sales that happened with the Mercedes-Benz, which is the first one that opened on the other side of the freeway, was $115 million in the first year. We don't get money from the sales of these vehicles. We get money from the service and from the parts as it comes, they come in. But it's because the intrinsic value of having 80 to 90% of the luxury vehicles located in San Juan, that this entire corridor that was going to be mauled over by what I say concrete beast is now being considered the golden corridor. And it's changed the future of our community. And we have, just next to Acura is another building, is the Audi, and next to Audi is a new business that came in from Mexico, Hillsong. They've invested $10 million in their business here. And they know that San Juan has an intrinsicness of the people that come here. So we have an inner, external market and internal market. Our external market are the folks that come to buy these luxury vehicles. And so we will cater to them because that's going to bring us jobs and monies. And then we have our internal market, which is us that live here in the surrounding communities, and we have our areas. But all of a sudden, this has become extremely valuable, this area, and what it is going to produce for us to be able, quality of life in our community, for jobs, and for just the economic boost that this place will have for this Rio Grande Valley. We are definitely a little, we're like a David and Goliath. We may be little, but we have a lot of potential. And I think most of us are going to be, you all for sure, are going to see the benefits of what is coming to our area through education and through the impact of the businesses that are coming and the industry that's coming. So you are what I have always said. When we break ground for all of these, it says you are on sacred ground. Because many people that came really sacrificed in many different ways to be here. So that we could be here, so that we could see this. Some of the people that came with us no longer live. But in that moment, they had a cause. And I think we taught that to each other, that if there is an impact that can be had when we all unite, and you've got a vision, and you've got to have vision. That I don't know, I'm praying that I'm going to get to see it in my term. The things that are to come, or at least make the development so that we know we can make a great impact. So I brought you here because I believe you are in sacred land and sacred ground in many ways. And that is my story that I want to tell you, particularly about this place. Do you have any questions?
So I wanted to ask you, you know, because you have been, you know, very instrumental in wanting to promote the murals,
yes,
in San Juan.
Yes.
And so why has that been important to you?
You know, it's important we tell our story and how we tell it. You know, I didn't grow up with my books talking about anybody who was Hispanic. The stories I learned were from my parents, or from hearing stories from our folks from Mexico or watching. It was never about us. And so when we first came in contact with Dr. Alvarez and the mural, and the fact that it's not just, okay, I want to paint this from my memory, but I want to paint this from the story of the people. I think that this is what I believe in. You know, we the people have a story. And when you talk to them, you hear about everything their lives are, their struggles, their aspirations, their beliefs about who we are and where we need to go. And when I heard the first concept the first time, I love that because our story has to be told. And it has to be about the people. I'm proud of my background. I'm proud to say I'm a migrant. I'm proud to say that I come from immigrants. Proud to say that we struggled. Our first house was, our floors were made up with dirt. We didn't have floors. We were aluminum sidings, you know? And when you hear those struggles and you share them through the art, then you know what? When we stand in front of that mural, someone's going to ask, well, why is that there? And what is that about? And you've got those stories. And eventually my next generation from my family is now just through storytelling, because they don't work in the fields anymore. Sometimes we threaten them to go work in the fields. Or they don't want to go to school. Right? And so I think that that's why it's important. We have to have that. We have our own identity and we can't lose it. And that's important to me. When I heard of you all doing the Mayfield part and the story behind that, I think that's awesome. What I loved about it, I remember I got a phone call, ma'am, they're telling us that there's too many girls on this. I said, what? I said, you're kidding me. I said, no, they're complaining. I said, first and above all, if it had been all boys and two girls, nobody would have picked up the phone and called, right? And so we got into a whole discussion about that, and then more discussion has come, but it starts the conversations. That's a different conversation. And one of the things that I heard this past Sunday at church, even through the church, was, you know, women has taken centuries to find our place, because we have been property in centuries, considered part of property, and eventually we've come to where we are now to, you know, equal human beings that have potential and ability, and it is what we teach our men, our young men, of how we value ourselves. And I am the first woman mayor the city's ever had. And so, you know, one of the things I have found in that too, and when we look at sports and we look at politics or whatever, when you're dealing in arenas where it's new, there's a lot to be encountered, and there's a story in that. And I think that what we can do, though, is we tell our story, and when you've accomplished good or bad, you leave a legacy, you leave a something that someone else can ask, well, how would I have done it, or what was that about, or how did that come about? So when you put these images on there, they have a lot of different meanings to many people. You see one thing, I see another. One of the things that I got a phone calls too about your mural, was there's a picture of the Virgin Mary. We're not all Catholic, you know? And of course, in talking, I see it as just part of the history. Hey, our emblem on our vehicles are the shrine, right? So it's just an identity of where we are. And I remember talking to Dr. Alvarez, and she talks to me about it's part of the history. And I go, yeah, that's how I see it. And, you know, folks were going to complain and said, but tomorrow, I'm gonna take a candle, I'm gonna kneel down and pray the rosary there, if people don't stop. Just kind of joking, but that's part of it. But it starts a conversation, and I'm not afraid of conversations. I think we need to talk. We need to be able to know that, and the arts are important. If something, we are people, that maybe we, all our folks weren't able to read, and maybe all our folks weren't able to communicate well, it was through painting and through music that we tell our stories. My father wrote corridos. My father spoke through the art and music about our lives. And we had all kinds of them. And art, I believe, is another thing. It's what those that could not have done that, but leave us a legacy and give us an opportunity to have something to talk about. And so when we go to see this, I see it all the time. And tell me, Dad, or what is this about? Or I remember, mijo, when my grandparents went and we did. So you spark that conversation, but more than you take a snapshot of who we are to kind of, you know, imprint it for generations to come. So it has value. And I think knowing where we come from is extremely important, so that we know where we're going, and we have a place, a rooted place, where we can come back and say, you know, this is what I've done, this is what we're going to do, and this is what we're going to do as we go. And we're growing really quickly as the majority in this nation, and we must be well-prepared, well-educated, and we must tell our story, especially in the light of the politics right now. I think it's important that we tell our stories. That's what
we've done is, you know, recovering some of these stories. Yeah. And one of the first things we said is, who is Mayfield? So we've been asking community members, what do you know, or have you heard through the stories about Tom Mayfield? Who do you know him to be?
Well, I can tell you the version that my parents and my grandparents gave you, and okay. I can try to give you a little bit of the historical. But my first learnings of Mayfield was that he was the law at the time that he was here in San Juan. I believe he was a constable or part of the sheriff's department. And Arrinche, the Rangers. The Mexicans here would call him Rinches. I'm not really sure how that came about, but we knew that when they said Rinche, it was not good. And the white part of town was south of the tracks, and the Mexican part was the north. And there was a school that we now call Clover, an old Clover, which is Idea School, which we call the Mexican School. And that's what it was called. And that's where the Mexicans went. And then there was Sorensen on the south side, and that's where the south went. Anyway, what I understand, what the legend that I hear about this gentleman was that the hotel was the last place that he lived. He lived his last of his years at the San Juan Hotel. The San Juan Hotel was an incredible place of commerce in the early 20th century, the 1918, 20th century, the 2020s, when it was being established along the railroad. So it was definitely a very viable, very beautiful place, and people would come to stay at the San Juan Hotel. So we were up and coming in that time just as well. And he found that to be his last years. He lived at that hotel. But during the time that he was here or in office, the talks were that we would find Mexicans hanging in trees by the hotel. So the image of the hotel is different depending who you speak to. Mm-hmm. That it's historical? Yes. Do we like the history or not like the history? Depends who you ask. Mm-hmm. And so the tree would be used where whatever happened, whatever the crime was, there would be a hanging and everyone would get to see that. Mm. And my understanding is that that was not an unusual occurrence then. So one day, my grandfather spoke of it, that he was Mexicans gathered to come at Mayfield. And so I don't know whether the intent was to actually kill him, and they might have been, or if it really even happened, but they hung him like they were hanging the Mexicans. And that's why he lost his voice, because you would hear him. It was le dicen el ronco. And they say it was because that at one point they were trying to hang him. He didn't die, and maybe they didn't let him die, but he lost his voice, and they call him El Ronco also. But there was terror in the times. I remember reading a letter from back in the times, and it was someone who lived in San Juan, and they said, we've heard that there's something great happening, there's some revolution. It's coming up from Raymondville. So my father went to go look, and they came to Alamo, and they rode over, because there were horses, they rode over to Alamo, and that came back. No, it was just bandidos. So it was like a whole bunch of Mexicans that were killed, and so, you know, everything's okay. But it was like the real nonchalant. It was just a whole bunch of Mexicans that were killed. It's settled, and it's over. And that's in the 1920s, you know, and early 19s and the 20s that this was being written about. Which, not too long ago, my parents were born in 27 and 26, so right where all of this was happening. But at one point, when I was starting growing up here, when I was getting older and so on, we were already past a lot of that, because we would go trick-or-treating on the south side, because that's where they gave bigger treats than the north side. So I think that at that time, yeah, things had settled, but that's kind of the history that we hear about Mayfield. And I think because I don't know how long it's been called Mayfield, but all my life it's been Mayfield.
Since 51, since before the change in the city commission.
Yeah, okay. And then it's never been touched. So, no. You know, and I've heard the stories, but you just never make the connection in a way. You become insensitized to it, that it's Mayfield. It's just Mayfield Park. But when you all started talking about it, yeah, we had the conversation. And there was a time in one of my meetings where the hotel was going to be revitalized, and somebody came to give the glorious history of the hotel. But of course I had members of my community that were well versed in the hotel. The next thing you know, ahí colgaban los mexicanos, los rinches. And I'm like, oh my God, this meeting's getting out of hand. One of them was my sister. she has been banned from my meeting since then. But I thought that was very incredible that the people were very passionate about it, you know? And it's just like, wow.
¿Por qué no se ha restaurado el hotel?
What?
Why hasn't the hotel been or done?
You know,
it's like a tourist thing.
Right. It's no. I think they keep it for the haunting aspect. It's been hands. It's gone through many hands. And right now, it's an attorney has it, and has not. I saw beautiful plans, but you know, because it's privately owned, they make their decisions into how they're going to invest into it. But there is definitely always talk about doing something historical. It's already a historical marker, but doing something to try to save that and bring it to full prosperity. I think there can be a reconciliation between us. And I think that how we go about it really can make that. And I don't think we have to wait for generations to not know it. I think we have to embrace it. And then we turn it around. Because anything can be, anything negative. Pues, mamá, no hay nada mal que por bien no venga. You know, there's always a way to make something that is, you know, it is what it is, but then you take it to the next step. And there could be a healing process for the city. And then it becomes, and at one point, it's just, it will be a story, but it's also going to be a center of people gathering and you know, building, being through a business, being through offices, being through, you know, they talk about a transportation area, you know, it could be a museum. Personally, I want something that generates taxes and generates sales tax, so we can continue building. But you know, so I think that's not in our hands. But so there's definitely room that has been talked about. How can we help you do something with it? And there was.
So it's basically up to just the owner, like the city right now has.
We have no ownership. It's privately. It's been privately owned always. It's never been part of the city.
Oh, okay.
It's not ours.
I want to go back about Mayfield Park.
Okay.
What do you think about the name? Do you like the name of the park?
I never thought much about the name in the sense of it's just Mayfield Park.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's, I can honestly say that I don't think anybody really gave it any thought until y'all started moving things, right?
Yeah. So,
thank you very much. So now I've got calls from Mayfield folks.
Really?
You know, they have their history,
right.
You know, and I think that's, you know, it's definitely been a talking point. It's stirred just incredible movement out there for all kinds of reasons. but, you know, I've not thought anything of it, really. But, you know, I don't know if the ordinance passed. Back in my first term, and I think you might know this, we did have... a big municipal park called after one of the ex-mayors from San Juan. And during that time, unfortunately, you know, sometimes we have dark periods in our history. There was a lot of things that happened in the school district, and our mayor, former mayor, was also sitting on the board as a superintendent and got indicted and charged and convicted. And so I started getting people to call me. It all came from the people. And next thing I know, I've got a petition in front of me. And believe me, it was something that had gone through my mind immediately was, do you keep the name of someone who's convicted for? You know, and there, it was a divide. It divided us, really. People who says, you know, but look at everything is done. And the people says, well, look at all of that has been done. And so it's just a huge conversation. And the people did start a petition, and it really was my conviction as well that I didn't think it should be there. And so when the people came forward, it was a very discussed topic. We changed the name. And it was not changed until it was a final, because people said, well, from the minute it was indicted, I said, no, people have to go through the process. You're either found guilty or not. And at this point, it did. And so it's still a very sore point. You know, and we changed the name. And so, what are you gonna change back? San Juan Municipal Park. And so we had ordinances that you need to be dead by the time you get a park or anything named after you. So we know your history.
Oh my God.
That way there's no surprises later. So that's kind of how we, well, that's what I believe the way they're going to be operating. So, you know, so as we start learning the history of this park, I mean, I'm definitely open to it. I don't know how the, I have to listen to also the community. You know, sometimes there's things I'd love to do by myself, but I can't. I mean, I'm not here to serve myself. I'm here to serve the people I serve.
So you would support a name change?
I would definitely consider it. You know, I think that's something that, like anything else, a point to discuss. You know, it's just, I think people don't know the history. We don't know it. You know, no kids know. I just play at Mayfield. Mm-hmm. You know, and so, you know, I've done it before, but I think it's definitely something that we want community input. I've got a lot of people in our community who have accomplished great things that probably don't do it to get recognized by naming anything. But we have role models that we have from our own city that have done a lot of things that we could definitely consider for other places. And that's one thing I'm definitely interested in doing in some buildings within our city, rooms within our city, of people that have just given so much of themselves to this community. I think it's important. Again, telling our story. I think that's important.
You said you're the first woman mayor here in San Juan. Uh-huh. What other obstacles? What usually male-dominated area?
It's been difficult. Mm-hmm. I'll give you one of my, I won't tell you them all, but some are not meant to be told. But my very first experience, I was, again, it's funny how the topics don't really matter. It's what happens. It's how you feel. It's what happened in the moment. That, whatever we're discussing, not really that important anymore. But I remember it was, I ran at a time when no one had really run in San Juan for about 15 years. Machines were not brought out because nobody would run. And so anybody that was going into office was basically appointed by the people that were there. We didn't have elections. But nobody told me that I couldn't do this, right? So, of course, somebody told me, hey, if I can help them with a library, maybe I can run for mayor, right? And so I had gotten my law degree and stuff, and so I won, which was inconceivable. I finally won after losing three times, and I won by myself. And I say that it was a slate. We were running slates, and I was the only one. So we go to this meeting, and of course now I'm leading the meetings, right? And so I am bringing this issue, and I'm very, very passionate about it. Apparently against everybody else's, and I remember that. All I was in this room, there was at least eight in the table, and I'm the only woman. And they're all turning and looking at me, and this is just, I don't know how I can say it's like this movie, and I shouldn't say this, I won't say it, okay, it's all right. So anyway, so I just feel like, oh my gosh. And it was just this attack, and it seemed more than the topic. I said, do you really? I mean, is it that important? I mean, is that to be the back and forth? It was really, really, really intense and very, very difficult. And I remember that I got to pray. I could not remember the words of the Our Father. I could not pray. I could not. I was so disturbed. It was so vicious. I remember it was vicious. And somehow it is, you know, eventually just, it's like, guys, come on, y'all have the majority. Y'all can vote. What's the big deal, right? But because I challenge. And I just remember that. And that's ingrained in me in a way of, I realized that it was going to be an uphill battle because they had not really worked with a woman as a leader. And I think it's taken time, but I can look at now with the folks that sit there, I can look at my employees. It's changed. It's very, unless I've matured, I've changed. So it goes both ways. I can be difficult. I can be stubborn. Right? But I realize though that it's not going to be as difficult for you or for you or for you. It shouldn't be. Because it becomes now we're all going to deal with each other. We're all capable. I'm going to listen to you. And I, my dream is that it's not going to be about a woman or a man. It's the most qualified person. Remember, it's taken centuries for us to get to this point. Centuries, faster. You know, the men got there faster. So it's still work to be done. But this is, when you all do this, go get yourselves educated. That's key. I know that one of the reasons I've been able to survive is because I am well educated. And that helps me. Because I want, and I am a lawyer, so I can defend myself. But I prepare. So I know I've got to really be very, very prepared because a lot is demanded. I have to be always very, very prepared. And I've got to realize, and I've learned to realize, I don't know everything. But I've got to surround myself with people who are way smarter than me because they make me look good because they got all the stuff that needs to be done. And not be intimidated by people who are smarter than me. I'm okay with that. You better be smarter than me. You're going to be my team so that we can work it. So I think that, you know, yeah. I've probably gone through things that a man in my position would probably not have gone through. But it's, you know, if I've been able to teach a few things, the lesson myself learned, I just, you know, all the others kind of fade away, all the other challenges. But they are there. I think you still find some, but not, it should not be as difficult as it might have been. I mean, I am the chairperson for the MPO. And had nothing to do with being a woman. It's just, you know, they always voted in. So I think that that's a good thing too.
So, but correct me if I'm wrong. You're the only woman that sits as mayor in the valley at this moment.
No, ma'am. There's five of us.
Now there's five.
Yes.
But there are very few women as elected officials.
There,
if you look at city councils, city commissions across the valley.
Definitely.
I mean, there's just it's very slim across the valley.
It's too slow.
It's way too slow. Even on school boards.
Oh, definitely.
There's hardly any women on school boards. So what needs to happen to make this change?
You gotta get past what I had to get past. Who wants to walk in to that kind of hustle? Why would you want to do that? And I'm telling you, is that we have to. And I mean, it becomes the guilt trip. I think in this is really more on the woman. You know, you think of, I'm not married. I have no children, so I don't have those real difficult constraints that others do. But if you're married and you have children, you do have very different kind of challenges. And in the workplace and in the world, the man really is allowed to go off and do, and someone stays at home. And in, I think a lot in our culture, there's a stigma of being the man staying behind with the kids, and the wife going, and you know, all the references that I get about being the woman leader, and then somebody said, la vieja, this is what I'm getting told, la vieja, you get this, and but we do it, right? Don't cry like a girl, you know. Parece vieja. You've heard those?
Yeah.
We have to stop that conversation. We have to stop those statements. Because we perpetuate that too. And so we can't. And I think that that's, culturally, it's probably even more difficult because we have a very defined, hey, you're the guy staying behind and the wife is the one, you know. But I think that we as women, and I tell you, the women that I know who are in leadership, they're strong women. I mean, they are phenomenal. They're todas preparadas y listas. So it's not impossible. And I think you just have to have the passion. You're going to have thick skin, really thick skin, and realize that a lot of what happens is not even personal because I tell you, you can't hate me, you don't know me. Once you know me, you hate me, está bien. But it's what we represent a lot of the times. But one of the things that I want to start here in San Juan, it's called the Million Women Mentors. And that's geared towards women to go into the STEM careers because they suffer a lot from that. The percentages of women in those areas last very little compared to the men because they feel isolated. They feel put aside. They don't ever really get to mix. And there is that sense of the guys. I remember my first gathering, kind of social thing, that was put together, all the men made the circle, right? And then I'm hablando. So I walk in, I make my room into the circle, and there's silence. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. it was very quiet. So I was like, I moved out and it began again. And so you have to work past those, you know, like, you have to. And then so you have your conversations. And I realized that those are tough. Those are hard to, you have to figure out how to maneuver through those and how to, you know, not feel that you're an outsider, that you're not wanted. You may not be, but so what? I'm at the table, I'm not going anywhere. And it's like that Lean In book that says we are at the table. You gotta keep your hand up until you get recognized. Don't put your hand down because nobody calls you. You keep it up until you're recognized. And I think that that's where we have to, we gotta do that. You just don't give up. And whatever you're doing, the next person benefits from that. And that's what I'm hoping. I'm hoping that it's not gonna be that hard in San Juan anymore. And there are five women. We Alamo has a woman mayor. Donna has a woman mayor. Diana Martinez is the mayor of Alamo. Irene Munoz is the mayor of Donna. Yvette Cabrera is the mayor of Granjeno. Celeste Sanchez is the mayor of San Benito. And so after the MPO meetings, we all go have lunch. That is a power lunch.
Any last questions or comments?
I have a question.
Sure.
Mayor, with your law background, is there any way, or give us some advice about, in 1915, there were like 14 bodies found at Alamo City Park.
Okay.
And we've been trying to get some information on how we can recognize the bodies by the plaque or blessing. So we've been going to the church to see if we can get some information on that, and we just really haven't gotten anywhere. So, what advice do you give us to see how we can go about doing this?
Let me just give a little bit more details on that. So what we found is in 1915,
okay.
Tom Mayfield, in an interview, said...
Your Tom.
He was head of the Rangers, Los Rangers, that's for better said. He was the head of the Rangers in the valley.
Yes.
Based out of this area. He was based out of here.
Right.
And he was involved with a massacre, to use the correct word, of Mexicanos, of 15 Mexicanos. And in his own words, to his knowledge, those bodies are buried to this day at Alamo City Park. Hmm. And we know exactly where. Miss Puebla, right?
Yes.
Has the blueprints of what that was at that time. Mm-hmm. And we have been going back and forth, trying to maybe get information from the church, because they would maybe have some of that. But he said this even in 1970. And he has said it a couple of times, but even in 1970 he says, to his knowledge, those bodies are still buried there. Hmm. So we've been trying to figure out what can we do to honor those people.
I think first of all, because it's in the city of Alamo, you definitely sit with the leadership. You let them know what your findings are. You let them know what your intent. It might be as easy as that. And of course, as a city leader, I would ask you to show me proof. I'm not going to be digging up my plants and everything on my park if you're not certain. So that's kind of where you have to come with the facts in hand. And then it definitely has to be proposed to them. And talk about it. Show what you have. And then ask that if there's a possibility, and that you would guarantee to believe everything where to find it. If you were to look, and I'm thinking digging. You're thinking of just a plaque, maybe. I don't know. But, I mean, those are the things that, if the proof is solid enough, then that, I believe, is your first step. If they were to say no, they have a right to say no on the property. The only one that would trump that would it be a state issue? Is there anything like that? Are there state monies? But really, because if it's our land, our property, it's our community, and it's our tax dollar, and so we would make those decisions based on to do or not to do. So I would, I think everyone's always open to sitting down and talking about it. And I say the facts are the facts. And if you were able to find family members, if you organize people, incredible. You might be able to find members that know that that's their family member or history of them, and bring them, you know, because it's real. So I think when you put the human touch to it, not just a store, but the, you know, this is how, these are the families and this is what we know, then I think they're open to it. So that's where I would start. Sit down with the leadership, with the city manager, and then bring your facts together, and then meet with the mayor, and then they talk about bringing it to the rest of the group. That way you always have all, the way I tell my folks to prepare our packages for meetings is you've got to have everything so that any question, you've got a way to answer, just prepared with whatever kind of questions we can.
There's another Texas, I mean, I graduated from theirs, but it's until I, at 15 years later, when I start a master's program, that I start actually learning about the history of San Juan and the history that goes on in our community. There's no Mexican-American studies, culture, class in high school right now, in any of the high schools. Would you support that? Or
absolutely.
What would you be able to encourage? Because I understand, like, your leadership in the city, not so much, well, not so much, but, you know, the education, yes, otra cosa, but, like, incorporating Mexican-American classes. Culture, education,
folklorico,
you know, San Juan, I don't think
has. We have folklorico, we have a banda, we have a grupo norteño, also as part of the music. We have mariachi, so don't we do? And I would definitely support it. I can tell you that the partnerships between the cities and the school districts have been improving tremendously. And we're not even just the cities. We talk about, okay, let's talk about what do we need to train our people in so that they become prepared for the kind of industry we want to bring. We know that the clusters are, you know, we talk about the clusters. So that's where you all, as educators, as creating curriculum, need to work at. If we're going to bring down, for example, Toyota, I want to use our people for those jobs, right? And I don't mean selling. I mean manufacturing. I mean building. If you're going to bring that down here, you want them to use your workforce. That's what you do. Build jobs, but the skill needs to be here. So as long as we're having those companies, which we are, Dr. King is pretty open to that, is these are our needs. And so, and it's not just, you know, the real hardcore stuff. It's also the, and I guess the arts is the one that typically gets put aside when all the money starts going, right? Mm-hmm. But it is important. And I think that there is a need to do that. I was asked by Lexus people, you know, what is it that, you know, we could do for the community? What kind of special projects? I said, I want to bring the symphony to the park. I said, our people cannot go to the symphony because we're not going to afford $50, $25 tickets, $125 tickets for the whole family. But I'd love to bring them to a park where we can bring our chairs like this, mom and dad and kids, and we sit down and we're open to a whole different world. And there's so much can be learned from that lies within us. You know, we can be lawyers, but we can also be making music and the arts in a different way. I don't write music. I just sing. But what I'm saying is they're very important. And so it has, when it's supported by the community, it has a better opportunity to...
Well, you guys have one of the best bilingual programs in high school right now, teaching the dual language.
Yes, that's a huge thing. So it definitely is something that... I would definitely support. I think it's important. Very
important. Anyone else? Last comments or questions from anybody?
Quick question. I noticed when you started mentioning that you did something for the library there. I live in La Villa.
Okay.
And I want to be a teacher, and my wife's asking me, where do you want to teach? I said, I want to teach here. I wasn't from La Villa. I moved there and stuff. That's
sure.
Where I live now. And I've always thought about, you know, there's, you have to leave your mark somewhere.
Yeah.
I mean, you're here for a reason, you have to leave your mark somewhere. And I know it's one of the things that our little town doesn't have is a library. You know, mm-hmm. The kids have to go to either Mercedes, they have to go to Westco or in Caltel somewhere. You know, they have no access to maybe some kind of... So I was telling my wife one time, one of the things, like, that's one thing I would like to do is find a way to bring a library, even if it's a small library, maybe it's a portable shack, just, you know, put it there for at least have access to some kind of internet access for the kids from my, you know, because they're not... They don't have, like, where other schools where everybody gets an iPad or everybody gets a laptop.
Sure.
Some of those kids, they don't have access to the internet.
We have 50 computers at ours because of that. Our community is one that typically, and maybe it's changing because technology is getting cheaper, have access to internet or to computers, and that was how it was built with that in mind. Our biggest, highest use is for the computer usage, believe it or not. And the trend in libraries is online. So you might want to rethink how you do the library, and it might become a place of maybe more a central learning resource center, because research really is being done more online. I love books. I love to hold a book in my hand still. But if we look at how the trend is, but it is important to have that becomes a central part of your community. And it has to be revolving around learning.
It not only services the kids. I've gone to the Calcells Club where you have adults that are bringing like work applications and, you know,
absolutely.
Job searches.
No, definitely.
Like
we have all kinds of folks that come in. We do programs for children. We do the ESLs. We do the preparing for GEDs. We do computer classes. It's a learning center. So I think if you make it multifaceted, it's an investment that your community can use as a resource, library as well, but then a learning center. And it has the school district, for example, ours has portables that they want to get rid of. That's one place to start. Can we take your portable to get started? We had a portable for about 10 years. And then it became this building eventually, you know, so there, it's a place to start. But I think there has to be a fundamental place where people meet and learn. And so I think you're on the right track. So it doesn't have to be elaborate, but you can be creative. Think outside the box how to get it. And what we want to hear as leaders is, okay, we only have so much money. How can you all help us think outside the box to make it possible? And how can we do it, right? So.
Something along the lines, same lines, something along the lines of, what about like a cultural center, like
yes,
just like you said, corridos is big here in music and art, but like a place where you can do it outside of school.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
The answer is yes, yes.
So we do this.
Yes, do this.
I do.
I just think that'd be a great idea, especially here.
You know what we do, November, and maybe y'all can keep this in mind, Doctor, for your classes event in this fall. We combine, this is going to be our third year. We bring artists from Oaxaca. And they do their, se dice carpeta de arena. And it is a tribute in Dia Los Muertos. And we do it in combination, and it's really great. The shrine allows us to use the back of where the mural is. The artists come, the consulate helps us. It's the consulate, the shrine, the city of San Juan, and the EDC. And it used to be IMAS also. And basically they bring their top artists with one of their top teachers, and they design based on what do you want to see. We did Cesar Chavez one year. We did the Oblate Fathers the other year. And so what's the theme? And then they do it in Dia Los Muertos type of thing with the skeletons, and they tell the story. Y lo hacen en arena with a bright, vibrant colors. And it takes them a few days so that the day of the dead is ready. And thousands of people get to enjoy it, and then they just leave it there. But it's an art form that they have brought here that had not been done. And now San Antonio is now doing it because they found out we were doing it. Mm-hmm. And so it's been used in Mexico all over. San Juan has been advertised as part of a place where they've done outreach, and it's meeting the cultures. And when they come, they bring their artisans, right? And they've got the food, and they share that with us. And so not just the art, they share their culture as well with us. And so it is a great thing. And I am excited about that. And so we're going to continue supporting that.
In November?
In November, the weekend right before Dia de los Muertos. We're going to do it again. They're coming. You know, we host them here. And they don't charge us. They just, you bring us, put us up, feed us. We'll share with you. And of course, you know, people in Oaxaca, they're mostrando el mole amarillo, el blanco, el negro. So we're eating all this kinds of crazy stuff, and I gave them barbecue, of course. And it's a great way to bring cultures together.
You know, when we went to the hotel, I think every single student that walked through is what they said is, this should be a cultural arts center. And I just say, because, you know, when my kids are in school in San Juan, of course, in elementary school, there's no art. So kids don't get any art unless maybe when they get to middle school or high school, they take art class.
Is that crazy?
They go to music once a week, a course, it's my favorite. Every day that it's music class, they're like, recorded music today! They wake up that day happy. But they don't get to learn to play an instrument.
Wow.
As children. Used to. And actually, thinking of your STEM initiative, music, learning an instrument is proven to help in math. There's actually a Harvard program that they teach, that they put instruments in schools to help improve math scores. It's just, and only a couple elementary schools have folklorico programs.
Yeah.
So there's no exposure to arts as young children,
right,
in the city.
Right.
So unless your parents can take,
afford it, yeah,
or,
exactly,
or even have time to take you somewhere, yeah, right, to
learn these things,
and then you have to go to like
yeah,
Edinburgh or something like that.
Well, I'm for it. I mean, that that's part of my vision.
Yeah. So I think that we can definitely maybe see how we can work on that.
Absolutely.
Making, I mean, that, I know the community would.
Oh my gosh, I think it's just it's something that we talk about, and I say dream because I look at the needs,
yeah,
and you're always driven, you know, by the, I want everyone to have a quality of life, and that means being able to have all, I still have 105 homes in the city that are not connected to sewer. But how did that happen? So we've got an application with the EDAP and the Water Development, Texas Water Development Board, getting grants and monies and making sure that everybody has that. I mean, there's still streets that have never been fixed. You know, that's the what I get complaints about and threats about, you know. So you got to do those, right? You've got to,
yeah,
do those. Those are basics.
They need to.
And so these are the ones that, you know, we've got to convince our community too that it really is a basic if we look at it. But it's always constraints. But I think one of the things is when we've got partnerships, it can move mountains. If it's just on one, it's difficult. But you've got, you know, the university and a group doing something, and you've got other people who, foundations that want to look at it, and you've got an opportunity. We have 71% of our kids are at risk, or 74%. North of the expressway is the majority of where they live. That's where I want to put that. You know, we want to put that. I can't say that. We. You know, and I think that we go to where the need is. And so with those kinds of numbers, they got to succeed. Our people have to succeed. We're not going to get rid of poverty until everybody's educated. We really have to work at it. And so it's not just a matter of, you know, the call and the t-shirt and the bumper sticker. We got to get, you know, our hands rolled, our sleeves rolled up, get our hands into it. And that really means how creatively can we get there to do that. And so we're working right now, the PSJ area, for that Century 21 scholarship that brings monies into our area for different things, and we have to be partnered up. We get extra points when you apply, when you're applying for grants. It's all on a point basis. By just being qualified, we have like 10 extra points above everybody else. And so we have united as a Tri-City to make sure we do that. Economic development through our housing, whatever we're doing at the city, combine it with the school district. I mean, we are a partnership. We're all standing together. We're all going to fight for the same things and, you know, strive for the same things. And then every individual community does its own thing, right? But we're regional. We have to think regionally. We can't think individually. And so through the MPO, we're looking at regionalizing so that this whole area becomes one region to receive more money. We're actually coming together to make this a one MSA from a Mission to Brownsville. What that does is then we use our resources to advertise as one body, not every city having to do the same thing. Isn't that smarter? You know, so those are the kind of movements that we have, which I think are phenomenal. I mean, you are at a time where this area is going to explode. We just got to be ready. So we want to position our cities to be ready for that. The way I see it is where it's a line from the movie Facing Your Giants. I don't know if you ever seen that, Facing the Giants. And it says, we're preparing the field for the rain. And that's what we do. Well, it might be that I don't get to see it, but somebody a long time ago believed enough that we would be sitting here to talk about our past history and our future that worked at it. Somebody's working these fields, cleaning them up to feed the families who are now needing. And so I think that's what we're doing right now. So can we do it? Yeah, we're just gonna prepare the field for the rain. And don't let nobody say it can't be done, because things can be done.
Thank you so much.
Well, thank you all for the opportunity. And if there's anything we can do in the city of San Juan, if there's another wall y'all like, just let us know. Just give me enough time to get ready for the for the history. But thank you, Dr. Alvarez, for all that you do.
Oh, no,
even in our city, she's real involved. She now sits at our Parks and Recreation Board. But doing this, you young people that have your whole lives ahead of you, I get excited. I think about when I was in college, and so exciting. Would I have ever dreamed my life come like this? No, it wasn't a part of my dream. But dreams develop as you go along. So go achieve. Go be the best that you can be, because I tell you that then you pull the people behind you, okay? Don't kick them down the ladder, you pull them up. And it just makes things, it's gonna be a great, this is gonna be the place where people are gonna wanna be is the valley. No longer the valley, no, it's gonna be the valley. So, good luck to you.
Before we leave, I wanna mention, this is Abraham Diaz. And he's a citizen of San Juan. And I read one of your reflections. Did you read my comments?
Of course not.
I write these comments and boost them. People read my comments. Anyways, I'll let him tell you, but do you want to tell just a little bit about what you wrote about the time we went to Liberty Park and we sat at the railroad, and how you felt afterwards in terms of how you feel as a citizen? Because you're a citizen, even if you're not a citizen, and what the class has done in terms of your feelings about someone.
So, we migrated from Nuevo León in 2002. The city that welcomed us was San Juan. So since 2002, we've been living in near Cesar Chavez and Houston, where the HEB is.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Before the HEB was there. I wrote in 83. And the only thing is that it's just really hard to fit in the history when you don't feel like these are your people. Now my family is not
right
in the valley or even in the U.S. And whenever they talk about our history, the few are left out. But I feel like, I guess I owe so much to San Juan that I should be part of it. I just don't know how to integrate it into myself or myself into it.
You know, I've never seen it that way, because I've always been from here. I think the embracing, my mother is the one that was from Mexico, and she wanted to be buried in Mexico, but she didn't want to live in Mexico because her heart stayed over there. But you make your own history when you come here. And when, you know, she established herself and her family here. And the fact that you become a part of it because you're contributing to it, you walk our streets, you live, you breathe the same air. And eventually it just you become part of San Juan. You become San Juan. You make it. And I think that's what I saw in them. They knew they were never going back. But they never let us forget where we were from and the stories. Because that tells you who you are. But once you're here, the way I see it is, I mean, we have a lot of people that come in and out. This is probably one of the places where we have a lot of new immigrants come in. So they're new chistas. You go north on Raúl Longoria, I mean, you see all the cuisine from Mexico. They come here, they're not looking for handouts. They want to know how they're going to get that permit to do that. And for me, I just admire. I mean, vienen to add and to contribute. And that is the truth. So I think that history, we all will make our history where we are. And I think that it enriches us all to understand, because I think here we all understand it. All, I mean, I'm the first generation here as well.
What's the connection you have with San Juan in Mexico?
So my grandpa, he has the primer danza de San Juan de los Lagos in Monterrey, Nuevo
León. Oh, really?
And I think it was when it was the opening of the new shrine, they brought the matachines here.
Really? The shrine, the one that got burned down?
Yes, the one that you burned.
Oh, this one? See. This one here?
In like the 70s, they came here. My mom has some pictures of her at the shrine.
Isn't that something?
Before she even got married. And then 20 years later,
here you are.
We're in San Juan.
Wow.
It's ancient. It's not ancient, but historical.
Absolutely. That's beautiful. That is. Thank you for sharing that. I mean, I think that the bigger the world, you're going to find out once you start traveling, we're not any different. We're not. And I think that somehow we all end up getting connected. I've gone some places and I've run into people from here, and or people love their families the way we love our families. They strive for the same things. And we all have our stories. And when people just want to, you know, when you sit down to talk like this, you just come to understand that we're all trying. We all want to have purpose. I think bottom line, we all want to have purpose. We're all going to, your entire life, you're looking for your purpose. And then when you become really good at something, you might need to stop and take a breath. That might be your purpose. Yeah. But we're always, and so there is purpose in you being here. There's purpose in where you're going. There's purpose in what you're studying. There's purpose. And that thing that all of us want to be acknowledged as having purpose too. From my smallest of folks that feel they don't have a voice because they're not legal here, verdad, to the ones who can be very outspoken. We all just want to have time, someone to validate us, to say, I hear you. You know, this is your story, and this is my story, and this is how we matter. There's a reason why you're here. And there's an impact that you have in the lives that surround you. You don't have to be, you know, in the limelight. This is Teacher Appreciation Week, and I thought of my first grade teacher, and I leave you with this story as a teacher. Almost everybody, of 10 of us, 8 of us have degrees, 3 of us have postgraduate degrees, you know, and the other 2 have college hours. And my first grade teacher, Mrs. Jimenez, said to me, we were in the first grade, all of us were sitting in class, and we talked about what we were going to do when we grow up, right? And she says, well, kids, you can be anything you want in this whole big world. You can be anything you want. And I tell them, I had an out-of-body experience. I saw myself leave, and I was like in space. And I looked down, and the world looked like this. And for me, what I captured was, it's not that big of a deal. We can do anything. I don't know how, that's always been ingrained in me, know where she was, and I got to see her. She remembered me. And I said, you impacted me. When you told me that, I believed you. You know, and I think for me, that always stays in my mind. We can be anything we want to be. This is strive. And so, I mean, the impact that we have when we teach our lessons, be it because we're teachers, because we're teaching where we work, we're teaching our children where we grow in our homes, there is an impact in that. That in itself. And that's part of what you're supposed to be doing, what I'm supposed to be. So never think that you don't have purpose. Never think that you don't have a story to tell. Never think that you don't have worth. Because you're here. Because you're all children of God. You're given purpose. So thank you. Thank you for your time. So do we bring lunch? No?
I was going to tell him, grab lunch on your way back to the mirror.
Congratulations to all of you that are graduating. How many of you are graduating?
Who's graduating? Wow. They've been. They're graduating.
All right. For more graduates. Yay.
How many are going to grad school?
Good. Good. Well, God bless you all.
Maybe later.
Never hesitate to call me if you need me. I'm always at City Hall, and I have my own law firm in McAllen. Thank you all.
Thank you.